My dear friend, today's topic is conservation of linear momentum. The term momentum you are using in different subjects of BTCM as well as BTW program. This topic is related to physics, that is engineering ET105A, and the momentum topic is also extensively used in the subsequent courses like engineering mechanics, fluid mechanics, engineering thermodynamics, and all the subsequent courses in the field of engineering and technology. My dear friend, today's topic is momentum, but you see that the topic is given the conservation of linear momentum. We often use linear momentum so as to differentiate a similar term with angular momentum. Now, the term momentum, you all know, we define momentum, that is mass times velocity. It is a vector quantity because velocity is a vector quantity and momentum is mass times velocity, that is why momentum is also a vector quantity. The unit for this momentum is kg meter per second, and the dimension for the term mv is ml t to the power minus 1. We will be discussing about momentum, different aspects of momentum. In the course of our discussion, we will also discuss about the three laws of Newton's impulse and other relevant topics. Along with me, one eminent teacher is with us, Dr. C.K. Ghosh. Now, I will request Dr. C.K. Ghosh to begin the discussion for today's topic, that is conservation of linear momentum, please.
Thank you, Dr. Maji, for this introduction as well as this opportunity to interact with the learners of BTCM and BTWRE. As has been very rightly pointed out by Dr. Maji, that the very expression momentum covers wide variety of topics in physics as well as engineering. And so, it is essential that the learners have a grasp of the basic concept of momentum. And then, of course, we would be discussing the conservation principle, the conservation law of linear momentum, which is one of the very vital conservation laws in physics. Now, first, let us make a recap of the very expression momentum, which I think you have been learning from your school science courses. Now, it has already been pointed out by Dr. Maji that momentum is the product of mass and velocity. Symbolically, it is mentioned as P is equal to mv. Now, this is neither a scalar product nor a vector product. Mass m is a scalar and v is a vector. And here you also understand why the mass m is called a scalar quantity. It is just a scaling factor. With that scaling factor, you have multiplied v, and so the momentum vector has the direction of the velocity vector. Momentum is a vector quantity, as Dr. Maji has already pointed out. Now, since p is equal to mv and m being a scalar, it is a scaling factor. So, it does not modify the direction of v. The direction of p is the same as that of v, like say when Sachin hits a cover drive. Now, the ball travels past the cover point. Now, it strikes the bat and travels. So, the velocity of the ball acts along the line which you can see. The ball moves along the turf, and that is the direction of the velocity of the ball. Likewise, the direction of momentum is the same as that of the velocity. And this momentum is the resultant momentum exerted by the bat and that of the ball before it strikes the bat. So, it is the resultant of these two momentum, and the resultant momentum is being a momentum is a vector quantity, and its direction is same as that of the velocity which the ball gets imparted with. So, the first point which I wanted to bring home is that momentum is a vector quantity and its direction is same as that of mass. Now, why we chose to define the product of mass and velocity? There are so many quantities which we handle in physics, like mass, length, time, displacement, acceleration, so on and so forth. Now, out of those, we had chosen two quantities, mass and velocity, and we have defined its product. What is its relevance? We have mentioned mass into velocity, but why? Now, think of a situation where we are encountered with some kind of an impact. For any impact, you require some mass to create that impact. Now, say on a rainy day, it is drizzling, or maybe some heavier drops are falling on your head. Now, when the heavier drops fall on your head, well, the impact is larger. You do not feel injured, but it strikes the head heavily. Suppose you have forgotten to carry your umbrella, but when it drizzles, well, the same drop will be striking your head, but you are not feeling that much of discomfort. So, in the first case, it is striking you with a greater velocity, whereas in the later case, it is striking you with a less velocity. And then if it is a hailstorm, then of course, you have to save your heads, because now it is not the water drops, but those particles in the form of ice. Now, the mass is heavier. So, the impact depends on velocity, and it also depends on mass. If the mass is fixed, now you see the batsman facing up to a bowler, and he is having a helmet, right? So, why is he wearing the helmet? He is wearing the helmet because he is facing a fast bowler, and he is wary about a possible impact which the ball may create on his head. So, Brian Lara, such a competent batsman, but he is also wary about being hit on the head by the ball. So, he is wearing a helmet. Now, normally, perhaps Brian Lara would not wear that helmet if he faces a spinner. Now, when Brian Lara is facing Glenn McGrath, and the same Brian Lara is facing Shane Warne. Now, Glenn McGrath bowls with a speed of about 130 to 140 kilometers per hour, whereas Shane Warne would be bowling with a speed of 90 to 100 kilometers per hour, or even less than that. So, with the same ball, 5.5 ounce ball, well, two kind of velocities are being encountered, or different kind of velocities are being encountered by the batsman. And so, the impact depends on velocity when mass is constant. This is something which we have to realize. Impact depends on velocity when mass is constant. The same cricket ball is creating different kind of impact when it is bowled by Shoaib Akhtar or Glenn McGrath, and then different when it is bowled by Harbhajan Singh, Kumble or Shane Warne. So, the impact depends on velocity when mass is constant, and the impact depends on mass when velocity is constant. That is, if, as I was giving the example of the raindrops falling and those ice particles falling during a hailstorm. So, in the latter case, your head gets struck with a greater impact. So, impact depends on mass when velocity is constant. So, you work out something of the form of joint variation which you had learnt in algebra. A varies as B when C is constant, and A varies as C when B is constant. Then A varies as B into C when both B and C vary. So, likewise here, impact depends on mass times velocity when both mass and velocity are variable. So, that is why it became relevant for the study of physics to define a quantity called mass times velocity, and we have named it momentum. So, now I will give you an exercise. Say Shoaib Akhtar delivers a ball at the rate of 150 kilometers per hour, and a cricket ball weighs about 150 gram, it is 5.5 ounce. So, if you convert into the CGS system, it comes to about 150 gram. So, say you have forgotten to wear your helmet, and you get struck by the delivery of Shoaib Akhtar. And say the impact on your head with that ball lasts for 0.1 second, then what would be the magnitude of the impact? The ball weighs about 150 gram. So, what you have to do basically, as Dr. Maji had pointed out, that the unit of momentum is kg meters per second. So, you have to convert 150 gram to kg, and you have to convert 150 kilometers per hour to meter per second, so that on multiplying them, you get the value of momentum of the ball. And then how to calculate the impact, how to calculate the force with which it hits the batsman. So, for that we need a recap of the second law of motion. Now, second law of motion says rate of change of momentum is equal to the applied force. Of course, the basic statement is like that, the rate of change of linear momentum is directly proportional to the impressed force, and it takes place in the direction in which the force is applied. And that proportionality constant is brought into the form of equality. Well, I am not making a recap of that thing, how we convert that proportionality to equality, but our working formula is rate of change of momentum, which you have seen in the notation of calculus, that it is equal to the applied force. So, what you have to calculate, it is ddt of p, it is not dp by dt, but say for a very small interval, infinitesimal interval delta t, well, it can be approximated or it can be estimated by calculating delta p by delta t. Now, what is delta p? Delta p is the change of momentum, and delta t is the time during which this change of momentum occurs. Now, in the case of that problem, well, before the ball had struck the batsman, the momentum was what you have calculated by now, I believe, m into v, by putting m is equal to the kg equivalent of 150 gram and the meter per second equivalent of the velocity, that is 150 kilometers per second. And after impact, the velocity is 0. So, the change in momentum is effectively the initial momentum of the ball, and delta t is the time during which this change has taken place, that is the duration of the impact, which is 0.01 second. So, if you calculate delta p by delta t, you get the value of the force. I hope by this time you have already done that calculation, and if you have done it correctly, it would be coming about 65 Newton. So, it is almost equal to say if you have a weight of 65 kg and if it accelerates at the rate of 1 meters per second square, the kind of force that is required to do that, you must have seen 50 kg weight say at a grocer's shop. So, if the 50 kg weight accelerates at the rate higher than 1 meters per second square, you calculate it, which it bring mass into acceleration to about 65 Newton, because you will be aware of that kind of a weight. So, the force that would be required is the force that gets generated when it hits the batsman's head. So, it is no wonder why he should come prepared with the helmet. You have seen that television advertisement where Rahul Dravid figures, that you should be very much careful and should be prepared by wearing that helmet. So, this is the magnitude aspect of the second law of Newton. And then let us look into the directionality aspect. Now, here, well, I will invite the attention of the learner to the issue of physical independence of force. See, we do a lot of exercise regarding the first part of the second statement of the second law, which is rate of change of momentum is equal to the applied force. But the second part of the statement is even more vital. It talks about the directionality aspect. It takes place in the direction in which the force is applied. Now, in the case of projectile motion, when say the footballer kicks the ball and the ball travels in a trajectory, which is a parabolic trajectory, provided there is no air resistance or any some such other non-conservative force. And then the only force, if we assume that there is no air resistance, the only force is the vertically acting gravitational force. And so, due to physical independence of force, only the vertical component of the velocity gets affected. If the initial velocity is u and the ball shoots up making an angle alpha with the horizontal direction, then u cos alpha is the horizontal component and u sin alpha is the vertical component. And if the mass of the ball is m, then m into u cos alpha is the horizontal momentum and m into u sin alpha is the vertical momentum. Now, this horizontal momentum does not change. What changes is the vertical momentum, because the force is acting vertically. So, it is an issue of the physical independence of force. Since there is no force in the horizontal direction, the horizontal momentum remains constant. But since there is a force in the vertical direction, the vertical momentum changes. So, you must remember this issue of physical independence of force. When the footballer is trying to kick the ball, which would give that kind of projectile trajectory. So, I hope you will be able to recall the statement of Newton's third law: to every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. And this leads us to the conservation principle of linear momentum. Now, even without the third law, say with the second law itself, if we feel that there is no force, it is a free body. If no force is acting on the system, then if you recall that mathematical expression dp dt equal to f, so it would read dp dt equal to a null vector, dp dt equal to 0. And if dp dt is equal to a null vector, then p is a constant vector. If dp dt is a null vector, then p is a constant vector. So, which essentially means that if no force is acting on a body, its momentum remains constant. So, this is the first approach towards the issue of conservation of linear momentum. But then it has, well, greater implications. Now, for a free body, as in the case of the horizontal momentum of the projectile, it remains constant because there was no horizontal force. Since f is equal to 0, dp dt equal to 0, and p is a constant. Now, there would be systems which would not be encountering any external force, but it would be moving on the basis of their mutual action and reaction. So, there comes your Newton's third law of motion, say the Earth-Moon system. Now, before I go to that Earth-Moon system, let us try to visualize a collision taking place, say between two pieces, two carom pieces, a collision takes place. So, say the first carom piece has a mass m1 and the second carom piece has a mass m2, and the force acting on 1 due to 2 is referred to as F12, and the force acting on 2 due to 1 is referred to as F21. So, please try to understand these notations, the suffixes. F12 is the force acting on 1 due to 2, and F21 is force acting on 2 due to 1. So, if you call F12 as the action force, F21 is the reaction force, and vice versa. So, call F12 as the action force, and then F12 is equal to minus F21 according to Newton's second law of motion. These are all vector quantities. And then prior to the collision, M1 was moving with a velocity U1 and M2 was moving with a velocity U2. And after collision, M1 is moving with a velocity V1 and M2 is moving with a velocity V2. So, what would be the change of momentum of M1? Change of momentum of M1 would be M1 V1 minus M1 U1. And say again, the impact lasts for delta t second. You remember that Shoaib Akhtar problem. The impact lasts for delta t second. So, the force on 1 due to 2 would be its change of momentum, that is m1 v1 minus m1 u1 divided by delta t. And whereas for the force acting on 2 due to 1 would be m2 v2 minus m2 u2 by delta t. Now, these two are equal and opposite. So, we have a negative sign, and thus m1 into v1 minus u1, that is, you take m1 common on the left hand side and m2 common on the right hand side. So, m1 v1 minus u1 by delta t is equal to m2 v2 minus u2 by delta t with a negative sign. And once you cancel the delta t's from the denominator, you get m1 u1 plus m2 u2 is equal to m1 v1 plus m2 v2, which says that total momentum before collision is equal to total momentum after collision. This is a vector equation. Here the m's are scalars, but the velocities, both u's and v's, are vectors, and this finds tremendous application in the scattering problem, say in the X-ray scattering problem of Compton, or even the optical analog of Compton scattering is Raman scattering, for which we had the only Nobel laureate in our country in the form of C.V. Raman. So, that is also a kind of a collision problem. And you come across several such collision problems while studying atomic and nuclear physics. So, you please try to remember that the total vector momentum before collision is equal to the total vector momentum after collision. And when you apply it to problems, well, you will be getting two equations. That is, once you resolve those equations along the x direction and y direction, you will be getting basically two equations. So, with the help of such equations, if you have two unknown quantities, my point to discuss with you was that if there are two unknown quantities, then these two unknown quantities can be obtained from the single equation. So, apparently it may look as a single equation, but basically it is two equations well aggregated into one vector equation, and two unknown quantities can be obtained from such equation. Well, this is just a recap of what I had just discussed, that for elastic collision in one dimension, m1 u1 plus m2 u2 is equal to m1 v1 plus m2 v2. Well, more about elastic collision later. So, now you see we have the exact form of the conservation law of momentum, that is when two or more bodies, right, when two or more bodies, say the sun, earth, moon system, so that is a three body system. So, when two or more bodies interact with one another, their total momentum remains constant provided no external forces are active. So, in the sun, earth, moon system, it is also all internal forces between sun, moon, sun, earth, these two are very big forces, and the internal force between the moon and the earth is negligible in comparison to them. And then the opposite forces, that is the force exerted by earth on sun, or the force exerted by moon on sun, and the force exerted by moon on earth. So, if you combine all these six forces, well, you have three pairs of action reaction forces, and this action reaction forces would be like that F 12 and F 21, which would mutually annul each other. So, more about that later. Let us come to this very common problem of the gun and bullet. Now, in this gun and bullet problem, well, you have seen what we can make out is the velocity that has been given to the bullet, and let the mass of the bullet be m. Now, this rifle had to be held against a very broad shoulder. You have seen Raghavendra Singh Rathod, who had brought that coveted silver medal for us in this last Olympic Games. So, he has a broad shoulder. So, why we require that broad shoulder? Now, the bullet, after being fired by the gun, will forces the gun to recoil, and this barrel of the gun that hits the shoulder. Now, why there is a recoil? When the gunpowder explodes, then only this comes into play. Before the explosion of the gunpowder, the total momentum of the gun and the bullet, by gun I mean really mean the barrel and the bullet is zero. And after the explosion, well, you are aware of the momentum of the bullet, say mass of the bullet is m and its velocity v, so its momentum would be mv. And so, this is not equal to 0, so there should be some other expression, and that I have written as the momentum of the gun, capital M into capital V. And from this relation we find that capital V is equal to minus mv by m. So, this minus sign indicates that the barrel recoils, that it goes in the direction opposite to the bullet. The same thing happens with the earth moon system, as well as the apple and the earth system. You remember that famous story, or the thought experiment I should say, which was performed by Newton, the apple falling on earth, and the idea of gravitation coming to him. It does not happen so easily. When in fact, the idea of gravitation came out of a lot of activities which had eminent scientists like Tycho Brahe, Johannes Kepler, and of course, how can we forget Galileo. So, but the interesting thing is, if you consider the earth and apple as a two body system, then the momentum of the apple plus the momentum of the earth is 0. And so, like the barrel of the gun, the earth also recoils towards the apple. You might be wondering whether ever it happens. In fact, the velocity of that recoil is so less, because v is equal to minus mv divided by capital M. So, here small m would be the mass of the apple and capital M would be the mass of earth. And so, you can understand what would be this ratio like. So, that velocity is extremely small, so small that it is not perceptible. But then this earth and apple is a very much valid two body system where this conservation principle applies. That is, if they move under their mutual action and reaction, then the total momentum is conserved. And since the total momentum is 0 before the explosion of the gunpowder, or say before the action of the apple falling onto the earth, or say before the universe came into existence. Well, like I am talking about the Earth Moon system, their total vector momentum is 0, because previously it was equal to 0. And I will quickly make a reference to a case of variable mass. I am talking about rocket motion. This is the rocket which you launch on Deepavali day. It is not the Thumba or the Cape Canaveral rocket, but the principle is all the same. You see the discharge of gas from the bottom. I am going to that good old law of Newton, that is second law ddt of mv, and this is v dm dt, presuming that the mass remains constant, the mass of the ejected gas, the velocity of the ejected gas remains constant. So, m dv dt is equal to 0, but then since the ejected gas is getting reduced, it is getting ejected, the mass varies with time. Now, this, there is a catch in this equation. Now, velocity of the gas, as you have seen in that diagram, it is in the downward direction, whereas the rocket moves in the upward direction. So, f is opposite to v. So, how it gets reflected through that mathematical equation? Now, please remember dm dt is negative, because m is reducing with time, m is decreasing with time. So, dm dt is negative, and so f is opposite to velocity. So, this is also a case of variation of momentum, but with the peculiarity that velocity remains constant and mass changes with time. So, I think we can visualize the first law as the momentum of a particle remains constant unless an external force acts on it. So, now we are bringing the concept of momentum into every law. Second law, you have also seen that rate of change of momentum is equal to the applied force. And when two body exerts action and reaction force on each other, the changes of momentum are equal and opposite. And also the issue of the elastic and inelastic collision, you have seen that equation m1 u1 plus m2 u2 is equal to m1 v1 plus m2 v2, which is true of any collision. But over and above that, if the kinetic energy remains constant, conserved, then it is an elastic collision. So, I will request Dr. Maji to discuss some of the problems, numerical problems, so that the learners feel confident about solving them. Dr. Maji, please.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Now, we can discuss few numericals with the understanding what we have during our course of discussion. So, this is a very interesting problem, that two blocks of masses m1 2 kg and m2 5 kg moving in the same directions along a frictionless surface with speed of 10 meter per second and 3 meter per second respectively. An ideal spring k 1120 newton per meter is attached to the backside of m2. Find the maximum compression of spring. This is a very interesting problem. You see that to have collision, the velocity of mass m1 has to be greater than the velocity of mass 2, otherwise collision will not take place. Then you see that on the backside of the mass m1, there is a spring attached. So, when the collision takes place, then there will be a compression of the spring, and we have to find out the maximum compression of the spring. As Dr. Ghosh already explained several times, that for elastic collision or inelastic collisions, that conservation of momentum is always there. So, first of all, let us see how we can get the combined velocity after compressions of the spring for mass 1 and mass 2 by applying conservation of momentum principle. So, you see that if we apply the conservation of momentum equation, that m1 u1 plus m2 u2 is the momentum before collision, the mass of m1 is 2 kg, velocity of m1, that is u1, is 10 meter per second, and m2 u2 are all given. And when the spring is compressed, then the mass m1 will be embedded with the mass m2. So, the combined velocity is v, that is m1 plus m2 into v. So, we can find out easily the value of the combined velocity of both the masses, that is 5 meter per second. After that, we have to apply the conservation of energy principle, that since it is an elastic collision, that kinetic energy itself will be conserved. So, we can find out what are the kinetic energies before collision and what are the total energy after collision. So, you see that the velocity of the combined system V is 5 meter per second, and we can get the kinetic energy for the two masses. But my dear friend, here you see that there is one more energy we have to consider, that is the potential energy due to the compression of the spring. In this case, you see that we have written the conservation of energy equation, that kinetic energy before a collision and equal to kinetic energy after collision plus energy absorbed by the spring due to the compression of the spring. So, here everything is given, only x is unknown. So, after little algebra, we can easily find out the value of x, that is the compression of the spring is 0.25 meter. Let us have a look for one very interesting problem, that is two bodies of masses m and 4m are moving with equal kinetic energies. The ratio of their linear momentum is, this is a very interesting problem, and Dr. Ghose has already mentioned that if the momentum is same, so if for the larger mass it will be having less velocity, but this case is says that two bodies of masses m and 4m are moving with equal kinetic energy, the ratio, what will be the ratio of the linear momentum for these two masses. So, we slide please. So, you see that p 1 by p 2, that is the ratio of the momentum, we can write in terms of m 1 under root m 1 e 1 by m 2 e 2. Since the energies are same, so e 1 e 2 will get cancelled. So, m 1 by m 2 will comes out to be 1 by 4, and if we take under root, that final result will be half. So, p 1 by p 2 will be half. Now, you see one more interesting problem, that this problem actually Dr. Ghose has already explained to you, that by conservation of momentum principle, that momentum, linear momentum before and after will be same. So, a bullet of mass m and velocity u is fixed into large block of mass capital M, find the velocity of the system. So, the final velocity of the system will be, of course, the right choice will be B. So, you can work out after writing down the equations. And this is also one more interesting problem, that a light body and a heavy body have the same momentum, which has the greater kinetic energy. So, we can find out the ratio of kinetic energy k e 1 by k e 2 in terms of under root m 1 v 1 square divided by m 2 v 2 square. So, we can write down, finally, we can get under root m 2 by m 1. Of course, if the mass is less, so the energy will be, kinetic energy will be more. And this is also a very interesting problem, an atomic nucleus at rest emits at alpha particle of mass 4u, the speed of the alpha particle is found to be 5.6 into 10 to the power 6 meter per second. Calculate the speed with which the nucleus of mass 218u recoils. So, we can apply the conservation of momentum principle and get, this is the same problem as the bullet and gun, as Dr. Ghose has already explained to you. And the last problem, that a body of mass 1 kg initially at rest explodes and breaks into 3 fragments having masses in the ratio of 1:2:3, the two pieces of equal masses fly off perpendicular to each other with a speed of 30 meter per second. What is the velocity of the heavier fragment? You might have already learned from Dr. Ghose that momentum is a vector quantity. Here you see that two lighter bodies are moving in a perpendicular directions. So, if we take the masses are m and 3m, so that the ratios will be 1:1:3. So, the momentum for the small lighter masses will be 30m and in a perpendicular direction. So, we can easily find out the resultant momentum, and that resultant momentum will be equal to the momentum of the heavier mass, and that momentum has to be in the opposite directions, and we can easily calculate the velocity of the heavier fragment. I hope that you have understood the today's topic, the momentum, and we had also discussed different numericals. Now, I will request Dr. Ghose to sum up our today's discussion, please.
We started with the definition of momentum, and normally I find that in textbooks we do not explain why we have at all defined momentum. what was the need of defining momentum, what was the need of defining a product of two terms, mass and velocity. So, I have tried to explain that with those problems from the game of cricket. I hope you have realized why we choose to have the product of mass and velocity. And then comes the most vital thing, that is the conservation principle. Now, for a free body, for a single free body, or say for a free particle, when no force is acting, the momentum is conserved. So, this is the basic statement of the conservation principle, that if no external force is acting, the momentum remains constant, which follows directly from the Newton's second law of motion. But then there would be systems which would be moving under their mutual action and reaction. And we picked up three such examples. We picked up the example of the gun and bullet, of course, after the explosion of the gunpowder, then the motion of the earth and apple, and the motion of the earth and moon. And for all such system, the total momentum is zero, because initially there is no motion. Before the explosion of the gunpowder, neither the bullet is moving nor the barrel of the gun is moving. So, the total momentum of this system is zero, and the total momentum continues to be zero even after the explosion of the gunpowder, and which leads to the concept of the recoil velocity of the gun. That is, unless in that equation you have another mv, you already had that mv, and you, in order to make the sum zero, you need to have another momentum, and the sum total of these two momenta is zero, which leads to the concept of recoil velocity, because capital V comes as small m by capital M into small v, but with a negative sign, and this negative sign indicates that it is a case of recoil of the gun. And the same thing happens with the earth moon system, the same thing happens with the earth apple system, and even for system of larger number of particles. Now, I assign this problem to you. You must have heard of the expression center of mass. Now, what happens to the center of mass of the system? If it is a two body system, the two body system would be having a center of mass. And what would be happening to the center of mass of the system? The system is moving under their mutual action and reaction, and since the system is in motion, the center of mass is also in motion. So, first try to assess what would happen to the motion, what would be the kind of description of the motion of the center of mass, and how it would be continuing its motion under the circumstances, that is, they are moving under their mutual action and reaction. So, please study that. You will be studying the very definition of momentum, the need for definition of momentum. You arrive at the principle of conservation through the second law, and then application of the third law, and solve this problem of center of mass. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you very much for listening our today's discussions on momentum, and I hope that everything is clear, because Dr. Ghose has nicely explained of momentum, and this will be definitely useful for understanding the courses on fluid mechanics, thermodynamics, where we will be extensively using the term momentum while describing Navier-Stokes equations, Euler's equations and all. Thank you very much. Even if you have any difficulties, you can contact Dr. C. K. Ghose. His address is there in your program guide. You can also contact Dr. Maji, and you can also ask your queries through telephone. We will love to answer your queries. Thank you very much.